always liked vinyl. I've always liked the way it sounds.
It does seem to have a clearer sound from what I've been able to see. It has a much clearer sound, and it also seems to there's a lot more you can do with it. I mean, don't get me wrong, CD art is wonderful, but I don't think it'll ever match vinyl art, because you can do a lot more with the art on a vinyl as well than you can with a CD. I mean, it's a limited canvas that you have there with the CD in terms
Absolutely.
Of like the visual art that you can do in terms of the promotions and everything, whereas I just think of some of the amazing vinyl art that was part of the album that we used to see back in the day. Like, of course, the Ohio Players had some amazing artwork, Earth, Wind, and Fire, and I could just go on and on naming some of those that had great artwork as part of what they were doing and things of that nature. And I'm thinking that if vinyl comes back, there may be more of those kind of collaborations that we have to some degree, but that might even bring more of the collaborations between, say, the visual artists and the musical artists, because I do know that existed, I want to say, back in the 60s and the 70s, where there were some known visual artists that were doing work with some of the other folks as well.
No, you're right. And I just remember the whole vinyl experience. You know, you'd go, you'd save your money, you'd go to the record store. I'd buy the record, I'd go home. I'd set up, you know, I'd put the record on the turntable, clean it off. Then I'd put a chair in the perfect spot in the room in between the speakers. I'd pour myself something to drink. I'd get the lights just right. And then you sit down and you listen to the first side, which was anywhere from 18 to 20 minutes or 15 to 20 minutes long. And then you get up for intermission, quick intermission, go over, you know, flip the record over and listen to the second side. It was like a ritual, you know, like a show. And nowadays with CDs, people can, or MP3 players, people can just hit shuffle play or listen to 20 seconds and it just hit a button to move on to the next thing. So I think the art of listening has changed too. So I'm happy to see vinyl making a comeback.
That actually brings up another question, because it seems to me that you talk about the art of listening changing. I remember when I was in both high school and college, there was all these music appreciation courses, and there seemed to be people that were definitely trying to get people to understand what the meaning behind the music was, not just listening to the music and letting the music just seek in that way, but there was these kind of music appreciation courses. I don't know if they're as active now as they used to be, and I was wondering if you think that we could – That's something that's lacking from our education system, because I do know that a lot of times if you have music appreciation, that helps develop your critical thinking and just also helps you have a greater understanding if you have an understanding of maybe what Beethoven was thinking when he was doing his music. So how do you feel we're doing in terms of music education? I mean, part of what y'all did at the Durham Music was definitely dealing with music education, but in terms of the grander scene, how do you think we're doing in that regard?
Well, I think there's still a lot of music appreciation classes going on. Every spring semester at ECU, well, I'm not teaching it this semester, but most spring semesters I teach a course called Jazz Pedagogy, and actually a lot of it is really, I think, kind of what you're describing, you know, listening to music and discussing. I'm not like necessarily so interested in trying to figure out what the composer was thinking or what they intended. I'm more interested in knowing what the listener thinks about it. You know what I mean? Like, I would like to ask 10 people who listen to Crawl, like what they think about it. What does it sound like to them? that's part of why I think we do this thing. You know, those of us who are involved in the arts, whether we're writing music or performing music or painting or writing poetry or choreographing dance or performing dance or sculpting things from different materials. I think that's the whole thing, is to get a reaction and to get a response. I have friends who are poets, and you know, sometimes it takes me a long time to figure out what I think the poem means to me, you know, but that's the beauty of it. I think for me, it's
the beauty. And also the beauty is that it can change. Cause like I said, you might hear the song one time and it might mean, or the poem one time and it might mean one thing, and then maybe you went through something that the poem is touching that changes the meaning of it to you at a later time. So like I said, you know, you may
hear
a song that means one thing, but then life happens and it totally changes the meaning of that song. I mean, I'm thinking, like I mentioned earlier, you know, and I think I'll get Dean to put that on very shortly, but I mentioned that one of my favorite Bill Withers songs was Grandma's Hands. And I mean, I think the reason I liked it was my grandmother was living at the time that that song was out and was very popular. Now, neither one of my grandparents are living, so of course it has a whole different meaning in terms of like reflecting on what they meant to me as a person, whereas when the song first came out, I was probably thinking literally about my grandma's hands, both, and particularly the one that was more church going. I mean, they were both attended a church or two in terms of going to church, but one was more of a church going woman than the other. And so I probably thought of her more when I thought of that song. But then as they both passed, the song meant my memories of both of them, both of my grandparents, so, and particularly both of my grandmothers. So I do think that the meanings change as we go about life.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Hey, Dean, if you could put on Grandma's Hands, and then I'm going to come back and talk a little bit more to Kenyatta and Scott as well. But just wanted folks to hear a little bit of that song. I think it's about 3 minutes long, but that is one of my favorites. And it should say Bill Withers' Grandma's Hands.
We got it. We got it right here. Bill Withers' Grandma's Hands here on Straight Talk with Dana Mark.
Most of us at some point in our lives have somebody that means more to us than anybody else has ever meant before or will ever mean again. Sometimes it's a long-legged lady if you're a man, or some tall, very smooth man if you're a woman. And in some odd cases, they get kind of crossed up. We won't talk about those. But in my case, I learned how to really love somebody from not a very pretty lady, not at that point in her life, not sexy at all, but just a nice old lady who used some very nice old gnarled hands to make life kind of nice for me at that time when I really needed somebody. And it wasn't after I got older and started to look around for things. It was before I even knew what I was looking for. And probably since I consider myself somebody who writes primarily, out of all the things that I might have written, my favorite thing that I've written has to be about this favorite old lady of mine. In church on Sunday morning, Grandma's hands played a tambourine so well. Grandma's hands used to issue out a warning. She'd say, Billy, don't you run so fast. Might fall on a piece of glass. Might be snakes there in that grass. Grandma's hands. Grandma understands that you really love that band. Put yourself in Jesus' hands, Grandma's hands. I, in Grandma's hands, used to hand me a piece of candy. Grandma's hands picked me up each time I fell. Don't you whip that boy? What you wanna spank him for? He didn't drop no apple core, but I don't have grandma anymore. If I get to heaven, I'll look for Grandma's hands. Thank you.
So, Scott, was there anybody that inspired you the way that Billy was talking about that his grandmother inspired him in terms of the musical career? And the same goes for Kenyatta as well. Is there anybody that really inspired you in terms of trying to get this career off the ground?
I didn't have a family figure, unfortunately, like Bill did, who inspired me. I think early on it was, as it is today, to a great degree, the people that I was working with. I moved to Greensboro, North Carolina, when I was a junior in high school, and I quickly fell into what was a very vibrant music scene. By the time I was like 19, I was playing in, you know, two or three different bands, and a lot of it was with people that were a little bit older than me, sometimes 7 or 8 years older than me, which when you're 18 or 19, that's different, you know. And there's a lot of great musicians that came out of Greensboro during that time period. A lot of them are still there. And it's still a very interesting kind of creative place. So I think that was my inspiration, was that I was just fortunate to be able to work with people really from almost the beginning. Like 3 or 4 years into playing guitar, halfway seriously, I was playing guitar in front of audiences.
And where did you move here from again, Scott? I'm sure you've told me in the past, but I forgot.
Well, I moved here from Auburn, Maine. We're right across the river from Lewiston, where Cassius Clay knocked out Sonny Liston in the first minute of the fight. But I'm from Chicago, and my mother still, well, she's actually back in Chicago now. I grew up in Chicago and then later the Chicago suburbs. There was a brief period where I lived in Dallas for a couple of years, but I came here from after 2.5 years in Maine.
Wow. And Kenyatta, is there anybody that's really been inspiring you in terms of your musical career as you're starting and developing it?
I mean, not really. I mean, like, musical people have inspired me, some of them. And my mom, me watching her over the years, she's really inspired me.
Okay. So she's a musician as well, or she's performed in the church that y'all go to or something along those lines?
No, my mother's a minister, so her talking to me and telling me, you know, go for it, just inspiring me and telling me to do it, go and do what I feel like doing. You know?
Well, that's good that you have got that kind of support from your parents and everything. I definitely want both of y'all to stay on the line. You know, we are in the middle of some very serious times, and I did have some people that were calling in to deal with what we're going through in that regard as well. So I do want to get back to y'all and to talk about how folks can get in touch with you, particularly you, Scott, and everything. But I did invite a young lady on that I had met through Shree to talk about what we're going through in terms of the current crisis and everything, and to give us more insight. So we've got a young lady on, so I'm getting ready to bring her on right now. So, Dean, if you could bring, and I'll have to get her to pronounce the name because I am horrible at Indian pronunciations, unfortunately, but I'm sure that she will give me the correct pronunciation, and then we'll find out what things are going and how things are going in New York and whether things are improving and whether people are doing, as we said earlier, I have heard that in North Carolina, people are actually practicing that whole thing of social distancing. So we're going to see if that's the case across the board.
Great.
Thanks. Dean?
Did you see me just now? Okay.
Hello. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm doing great.
Hello.
Thank you. How are you?
I'm doing good. If you would, Doctor, pronounce your last name. Like I said earlier, I am horrible with last names of folks from India and things of that nature. I hate to say that. I
no
should
worries.
Do better.
No worries. Dr. Chandra Shekhar.
Chandra Shaker. So tell us a little bit about your work in the New York, I believe.